throne of Atlantis continues to march forward. After escaping the Dark Waters, the Justice League regroups in the Watchtower. All parties are shocked that Volko was behind the attack on Atlantis. Arthur feels the entire conflict is his fault. If he hadn't renounced his throne, Volko never would have been banished and thus would have never fired the missiles. Back in Boston, the battle has grown chaotic. The new Justice League recruits are still fighting the invading Atlantean army. At the same time, the trench creatures are attacking both sides. However, the core Justice League boom tombs in, much to the relief of the recruits. Aquaman immediately engages Ocean Master. As the two savagely fight, Arthur attempts to explain Volko's involvement in the situation. Orm refuses to believe Arthur's side of the story and reaffirms that he must protect Atlantis. From a safe distance, Volko watches the battle unfold. He looks on with delight as Aquaman begins to gain the upper hand. Arthur comes to the conclusion that he cannot change Orm's mind, that he must reclaim the throne he never wanted. With a single punch, he breaks Ocean Master's helmet, which prevents his control over the ocean. Orm yields as Aquaman towers above him. At first, the Atlantean army thinks they must kill Aquaman. However, Aquaman turns to face them and demands the respect. He proclaims, "I am your king." With Aquaman once again king, Volko immediately surrenders. His plan is complete and he hands the Scepter of Atlantis over to Aquaman. Using the scepter, Aquaman orders the trench creatures back into their deep water home. As the issue closes, Batman comes to the conclusion that the Justice League needs to expand. Amanda Waller decides that it is the perfect time for the Justice League of America to debut. And lastly, an unknown figure feels it is time to start recruitment for their team of villains.
So before we get into what's going to be coming next for the Justice League, let's look at how Throne of Atlantis ended.
It ended in a very dramatic way, I thought. Arthur's king. I guess we all kind of saw that coming.
Yeah, I was kind of disappointed that that was the end result of this, Arthur is king. Because we basically saw that coming from the first...
Well, it's his destiny, so...
I mean, I think the Throne of Atlantis name sort of gives it away, too.
I mean, really, this event seemed to set up more future storylines for both Justice League and Aquaman, because now in Aquaman, he's going to have to, you know, go back to Atlantis, be away from Mira,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, take his place as king, and then, you know, Justice League is going through this now roster change type events.
And we'll get into that, but let's keep looking at the actual end. Last issue, we saw Volko was the real culprit.
Right, and we discussed what was his motives behind opening up the trench. And we speculated that, you know, maybe there's some way for him to accumulate more power. But really, it was just to push Aquaman into being king again.
And there's scenes where he's just sort of looking at what's going on. And he's got that sort of like a proud parent face on him.
Yeah.
And
I was a little disappointed, actually, with the Volko storyline. I kind of wish he would have been maybe a little more selfish or, you know,
underhanded in some way.
Whereas now he's like, it's very... almost Machiavellian of him, like, oh, I'm the ends justify the means. If I can get Arthur to be king again, mm-hmm. everything I did is okay. I just really love the scene, though, where after he defeats Orm and Orm mm-hmm. Surrenders to him, and then all the Atlanteans are like, oh, he beat King Orm, kill him. And then Aquaman's like, I'm your king now.
That really was, like, artistically, that was also an amazing scene. The art in this issue itself was amazing.
Yeah,
there's so much water splashing around, and we talked about this before, but I love it when they have the water splashing around in Justice.
Ivan Reis does just an incredible job. He deserves as much credit for making Throne of Atlantis a success as Geoff Johns does, in my opinion.
Agreed. Okay. One of the important scenes, and you brought it up already, where Orm sort of yields the throne to Arthur, I almost felt that was kind of rushed, and it seemed to me that it was almost ridiculous. The way it sets it up is like, if anyone can beat the shit out of your king, he can yield the throne to you.
Yeah. I mean, what civilized society does that?
Exactly.
I just feel like Atlantis would be a kingdom where everybody's constantly challenging the king so they could become the king.
And then not only does he yield the throne, that screws him over. I thought Arthur was being a complete dick. I understand that Orm did some...
Yeah, but he was protecting his kingdom.
Exactly. It was like an act of war. He perceived it as an act of war against him, and then it was like war began. And you're basically punishing this guy for...
doing his duty as a ruler, basically.
Yeah, but then it comes into the sort of gray area of what war crimes were actually committed, what weren't, what was his fault, and what wasn't, what was unnecessary...
So we get to see him at Belroof Prison, and he's asking for water because he's obviously dehydrated since Atlanteans need more water.
Yeah.
And I think this is just going to push him on a path to becoming a villain because he needs to be
a
villain again.
It definitely is. It seems that Arthur really just screwed him.
So let's also take a look at the last page of the issue, which kind of sets up the future of the Justice League series as well as maybe the DC Universe kind of as a whole. They show Batman saying, we need more members in the team. Mm-hmm. We also see Amanda Waller saying, it's time for the Justice League of America to take shape. And we'll do a Justice League of America review also this week, so keep an eye out for that. And we also get to see some third unknown person assembling his own, his or her own team of presumably villains. He says we need to start with Scarecrow. We also see like people like Poison Ivy, Cheetah, and we also see some people from the Flash Rogue Gallery. So who do you think this mysterious figure is putting together this group of villains?
Well, it's got to be someone big. And the obvious name that jumps in my mind is Lex Luthor.
Like a new Injustice gang.
Yeah, but I don't know if that's actually the case. So obviously, this new villain group is forming, but maybe the Justice League is also going to change.
Right.
Because it does seem that Aquaman is going to be... Being a king seems like a full-time job.
No, he'll still be in.
You think so?
But we'll definitely hopefully see The Flash and Green Lantern come back.
Yeah.
Because, you know, those you got to have them on the Justice League.
So, what would you give as a grade to Justice League number 17?
I'm going to give this issue a 4.5 out of 5. It just reinforces what a great event Throne of Atlantis was, and I would say this might be DC's best event of the past 6 months.
Wow, that was a bold statement with Death of the Family just concluding.
I stand by it.
Oh, wow. I'm going to give this issue a 4 out of 5, and most of that's because of the amazingly strong artwork. I was a little disappointed in what Volko's plan eventually turned out to be, but overall, still a very strong event.
So thanks for watching B3 Comics review of Justice League number 17. Before we go, though, we got a question for you guys.
How would you guys compare this event to Death of the Family?
Leave your answer below in the comments. Also, be sure to check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and please subscribe.